Okay, hello. So I am Eric Armango. I'm working here, in fact, at CEA. And I'm going to present, so in fact, it's a dark matter model, but this is a scalar field, so it's not too far from dark energy. And so it's based on a work that we published recently. So the model itself is called fuzzy dark matter. I don't know if many of you heard about it. So you know that there are many dark matter candidates, maybe more than modified gravity theories. And in this very vast landscape, fuzzy dark matter is the lowest possible dark matter particle. So the mass range is around 10 to the minus 22 eV. And so this model is here since quite a long time. So you see it here on this plot, which shows different dark matter candidates. It's here. In fact, the seminal paper is from Wayne Hu in a 2000 paper. The best to describe the best thing to describe this candidate would be wave dark matter, but WDM is already taken, so fuzzy dark matter is what we will use. So the idea behind this is just, first of all, what is the lowest possible mass for a dark matter particle? If this is a fermion, then the exclusion, just Pauli's exclusion principle, applied in some astrophysical objects, in particular the dwarf galaxies, imply that the mass must be larger than something like 400 eV in a model-independent way. If dark matter is the dark matter particles are boson, so it's a bosonic field, it can the mass can be much smaller. You know that the standard QCD axion so is typically a micro to milli electron volt, and in fact, nothing forbids dark matter masses down to something like 10 to the minus 24 eV. So at this mass, what happens is that, so it's the uncertainty principle implies that there is a length scale, the de Broglie wavelength, and this wavelength becomes really big on astrophysical and cosmological scale. And this formula just illustrates the order of magnitude for a 10 to the minus 22 eV particle. With velocities that are typical of a small, very small galaxies, you get the size of the galaxy. So, of course, all the phenomenology of halo dynamics and structure of large scale structure formations is then changed. Okay, so this fuzzy dark matter is also a good candidate to solve the so-called small scale crisis of cold dark matter. So you know that there are basically, so the dark matter density profiles or halo abundances are not well reproduced by pure CDM simulations. It's a small scale problem. Feedback, the effect of baryon physics, can solve the issue. But it is also possible that it opens the door to specific dark matter properties which would smooth, the basic idea is to smooth density fluctuations, the power spectrum, at very small scales, okay? So warm dark matter, self-interacting dark matter, and fuzzy dark matter are examples. So how do we describe such a dark matter particle? Well, it's just a scalar field with a classical evolution because the occupation number is very large, so okay, it's like a scalar field in cosmology, the evolution so is like that if we forget couplings, self-couplings or couplings with other fields. And as long as the mass of the particle, so early enough in the universe, in this model, the mass is smaller than the Hubble rate. So in fact, it's not dark matter, it's dark, it's a cosmological constant. So here you see the field as a function of scale factor. It starts as a cosmological constant, and then when the mass is equal to h, it oscillates. The density, so which is constant in the dark energy regime, after oscillation goes down like a to the minus 3, so it behaves at late times exactly like dark matter, as you expect. So that's the misalignment mechanism, which if you have an initial value for the density, for the dark matter density, you can know what is the density now. And the question is, okay, why 10 to the minus 22? Is it plausible or not? And there is, well, it's an argument which is not extremely strong, but which is there, to motivate this value of the mass, a theoretical argument. So if you believe in string theory and compactification, you predict many axion-like particles. So these fields are in fact pseudo-scalar fields. They are angles, okay, associated to grand unification. And so the field itself has a Lagrangian which is like that, typically. So the energy scale which appears here is typically, you expect it to be between grand unification and Planck scale. And the potential, so which gives the mass, can be whatever you want. It is really not prescribed because this is from non-perturbative effect. It's associated to unknown gauge fields, unknown physics. This is really a free parameter. So the mass is just a free parameter. And when you compute in the simplest way possible the relic density from the misalignment mechanism, so you starting from this, okay? So you know the field starts to oscillate at this temperature. And initially the field density, so the energy density is of the order of mu of this parameter here, this free parameter here, assuming that there is no fine tuning. So the initial value of the angle of your scalar, of your pseudo-scalar field is of the order of one. If it's zero, okay, it doesn't work. And then the relic density is given by this formula with two free parameters, F and M, and other known observables. And so this was highlighted in the recent paper by Hui, Witten, et al. And you see that if you take GUT for this, or this is the mean between GUT and Planck, this value permits to get the right relic density, 10 to the minus 22. So that's just a reason for also getting interested in this value. So what happens then, what I'm going to present now, I'm not going to present the phenomenology at very small scales with such particles. People have done some simulations of the Schrödinger, because then the correct equation is a Schrödinger equation on galactic scales to couple to gravity. So it's very interesting, but I'm not going to present that. What I'm going to present is constraints that we get from cosmological probes, especially on small scales. So structure formation for such a dark matter particle, you get it by plugging your scalar field in the perturbation, in the linear perturbation theory. In fact, you find that your dark matter fluid has an effective Sarnoff speed. This is valid only for linear perturbation. This is an effective speed of sound. And as you know, when you have a fluid in a gravitating fluid with a speed of sound, you stop. Gravity cannot work on scales smaller than the Jeans scale, where pressure will stop the free fall process. And the Jeans scale is given by this formula with the orders of magnitude that are given. So this is the Jeans scale associated to this speed of sound. So you cut off, the result is that during structure formation, scales that are smaller than the Jeans scale at equality are just cut off. They don't grow. Structures cannot grow at smaller scales. So the power spectrum, this is the linear power spectrum. So lambda CDM is the green one, or almost red. And you see that when you put smaller and smaller dark matter masses, you cut off the power spectrum. So if you have a dark matter mass here at 10 to the minus 10, 26, 27, in fact, the BAO scale, whatever, are completely cut off. So this is strongly excluded by everything we know about cosmology now. In fact, so a complete fit of, so you have here, this is a model with a dark matter fluid with a given relic abundance. And this is the exclusion plot using only linear cosmological probes, so CMB plus very large-scale structures. And they exclude dark matter masses smaller than 10 to the minus 24. And of course, you see that if your scalar field goes down to 10 to the minus 33, then, okay, it behaves like dark energy, since in that case, the mass is equal to H0. So to probe smaller dark matter masses down to 10 to the minus 22, we need probes that will go to smaller scales, okay, in the structure. So nonlinear and more dirty probes like galaxy luminosity functions, reionizations. And I'm going to focus, just as an example, let's say, on the Lyman alpha forest, which is the work that we done, and on which we are a bit specialized here at Saclay. So I remind you that Riemann alpha forest is just, you measure the flux, you measure the spectrum from a quasar, and you measure also an absorption spectrum. So the light as the light passes through from the quasar to the observer, it is absorbed by the intergalactic medium, and you have a set of lines due to the redshift effects. So your observable is the one-dimensional power spectrum of these strongly varying absorption lines, and it's closely related to the small-scale matter power spectrum. So we use basically for this study we use the SDSS quasar spectrum from the BOSS survey, and we probe so scales down to a megaparsec typically, so very nonlinear and small scales. To make predictions of the Lyman alpha forest in a given cosmological model, we have a kind of machinery. So we start with a linear power spectrum. So this is again the linear power spectrum but divided by CDM for different action models. So, well, I say action for different scalar field models with different masses. So you see clearly the cutoff, which is computed using, so this is a modification of CAMB. And you see the comparison, so the cutoff is very similar to warm dark matter models in which the cutoff is generated by free streaming effect. But the shape is different, so you have to take this into account. Then, concerning the dirty things, to include nonlinear physics and, most importantly, hydrodynamics of the intergalactic medium, we use GADGET 3 simulations with a set of parameters. Okay, so there are cosmological parameters, but more importantly, astrophysical parameters linked to the IGM physics. So this allows us to predict for a given set of parameters the observable Lyman alpha forest flux. And this is the kind of thing we predict. So these are, here you see the data in some model predictions of the flux on small scales. And here you see, in fact, the cutoff, which has, in fact, the linear cutoff, you see it is really sharp at a given value of k. But after nonlinear processes, etc., the cutoff is not so sharp. You see here, this is the ratio of observable flux power spectrum divided by CDM. In yellow, this is warm dark matter models, and in green, for fuzzy dark matter models. So we measure a few percent variations of the flux, in fact. In the end, so we turn a small statistical machinery, and depending on what we do exactly, we get bounds from the SDSS Lyman alpha forest at the level of 2 times 10 to the minus 21 eV. If we include higher resolution spectra from other observatories with much less statistics but able to resolve smaller scales, okay, this is goes to the same order of magnitude, and another team found the same results, in fact, from Irsic et al. Of course, these limits should be taken with a grain of salt because this is based on dirty intergalactic medium physics. So where we have a set of, we model as much as we can the intergalactic medium physics. So this is taken into account as much as we can, but we have to remind that this constraints are less robust than the linear physics constraints. There is also another problem, which is more interesting, in fact. Can we use GADGET 3 n-body simulations in that case? Because in that case, the real physics is given by Schrödinger equation for our dark matter fluid. Okay, we're in a Newtonian regime, so this is Schrödinger equation. So Schrödinger equation can be translated if you just separate real and imaginary parts. You can derive from the Schrödinger equation an equation which is very similar to the standard hydrodynamics Euler's hydrodynamics equation, which is Madelung. Okay, you take, I think, from the real part you get just density conservation, and from the imaginary part you get the dynamics, which is this. Okay, you identify the dark matter density as the modulus of the wave function, and the phase is the velocity, or variations of the phase of your wave function is the density. This is very similar to what is done in superconductivity, in fact. And we get exactly the same thing as Euler's equation with gravity. Okay, this is the Poisson. This is just gravity. This is the Hubble flow. But there is something else. And this something else proportional to h bar square is called quantum pressure. This is really just the effect of the fact that this is the effect of the uncertainty principle. The fact that the de Broglie way, you cannot localize your dark matter fluid better than on a de Broglie wavelength. So n-body codes, in fact, so gadgets, they solve Euler-Poisson system. Exactly, that's what they do by sampling particles. So they do this, but they neglect the quantum pressure term. Some people, in fact, there is a team which solved directly the Schrödinger equations, but on scales much smaller than what we want to do. Some people have started to implement, in fact, the quantum pressure in gadget. We did not. In fact, it's hard. It's hard because this is, in the end, the force is a third order derivative, and in large scale simulations, this is very hard to compute. So what we did is neglect this term for computing, in order to compute nonlinear evolution. And we checked a posteriori that this is a good approximation for our problem. So here, these are small gadget snapshots of dark matter. So these are 5 megaparsecs, so very small scale.
So you are solving the fluid equation without the quantum pressure?
Yeah, without the quantum pressure.
You are solving perfect fluid?
Yeah, exactly.
And you converge?
For dark matter, yes. Because in fact, the goal of these simulations is really to include the hydrodynamics of the hydrogen. So. Yeah, no. This is n-body. No, this is n-body. This is gadget n-body. Just a standard CDM. We make the standard CDM approximation. We make the standard CDM approximation in the calculation for the nonlinear evolution. And this is, so this is the standard CDM, okay? And this is the same snapshot, but with the initial fuzzy dark matter linear power spectrum, which is smoothed because initially you made we had a cutoff at high redshift, and we computed this is n-body, just n-body, and what we just did is compute the gravitational potential as well as so-called quantum pressure, and compared them or compared the associated forces in the simulations that we drawn, and found, so these are the histograms for all the particles that we followed. The histograms of this ratio for different values of the dark matter mass. And we found that the gravitational force is very, very dominant, at least for masses larger than 10 to the minus 22.
How did you estimate the quantum pressure? Because it involves the gradients of the density, and
instead
you have.
We smooth, so this is within the resolution where we are able to reach for the simulation. So. It means that it's on a scale of something like a few hundreds of kiloparsec. Yeah. Yeah. So that's adapted to the resolution. In fact, it's an estimate only, and it works well at the scale of filaments. Now we don't resolve the cores of the halos. The halo cores, anyway, we know that quantum effects are very important in this scenario, but we don't resolve them for what we want to do. For Lyman alpha forest specifically. And that's it. So in the end, fuzzy dark matter, so it's a pseudo scalar field with a mass, well defined mass around 10 to the minus 22 eV. It's very interesting, especially in terms of phenomenology. And currently, we have with the Lyman alpha forest a strong constraint on this scenario. This is similar, in fact, to the bounds that are set on a warm dark matter or also on the mass of neutrinos, of standard neutrinos. This is a strong constraint. However, we have to remind that in the first there is this IGM physics modeling, and more importantly, we may need to take into account this quantum pressure, but for low values of the mass. So we exclude mass ranges between 10 to the minus 22 and 10 to minus 21, let's say, EV.
Thank you.
I can shout.
No, you can't shout because you won't be heard.
So can you comment more on the point of intergalactic medium and optical depth, or
What do you want?
Which
this?
Are the, well, I understand that this is the main.
This?
Well, the I understand that this is one of the main sources of uncertainty in the
yeah.
in the meta. So
yes.
What do you?
So what? In fact, we need to model the thermodynamics of the intergalactic medium. So, well, these there we have a temporal. We model the evolution. In fact, it's including. There are two free parameters in gadget 3 that mimic the evolution of the temperature of the intergalactic medium with redshift, of average temperature. What we do not model at all is the fact that you can also have fluctuations of the intergalactic medium of non-gravitational origin, not related to dark matter. That's the case of feedback, basically. In that case, what we do is just, in fact, parameterize the associated deviations of our observable, of our flux power spectrum, using other simulations published in the literature. We make very simple parameterizations with three parameters and including them as nuisance parameters to derive the constraint. This is a way to take these things into account, which is not perfect, but which should capture most of the uncertainties.
Can you talk a bit about lower bounds? On this is upper bounds, I mean, on the mass. Don't you get?
This is the lower bound.
This is the lower bound. But there are some upper bounds also. How does that they compare to?
On dark matter mass?
No, on the fuzzy dark matter mass.
What do you mean?
I don't know the literature that well. I just remembered seeing some papers that we have some. So is there only a lower bound that we have on this?
Oh yeah, then you can have whatever mass between 10 to the minus 22 and the Planck mass in principle. You have models for...
Scalar, yeah. Hmm?
Why not?
One-tenth
of electron volt.
To be able to describe it as a scalar field, as a coherent, you know, like... entity, you need large occupation numbers. And that happens if the mass is lower than, I think, one-tenth of electron volt.
Yes, at some point it behaves like a gas of particles.
Yeah, so it will be completely different dynamics.
Just a short comment, because in principle we don't know what we call dark matter. The cosmological framework is something that scales proportional to 1/8 to the cube.
Yeah.
What we call dark matter now in the bullet cluster or in the galaxy rotation curve, I mean, it's something that could be based on particle. I mean, in principle, these two mechanisms could be the same, but they could be different. So in that case, both could be applicable.
Yeah.
More questions? Okay, if not, thank you. Thanks again.